The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWM podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And as we're on the run-up to the end of season two, I am joined on this edition with the Orbit Breaker himself, Daz Black. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. Thanks a lot.
So I'm very excited to have you on the show because you're doing all right at the moment on the whole WWE Network side of things, which we'll get to a little bit later on. But the first question is always the same. How did you get into pro wrestling and what got you hooked?
Well, what got me hooked, I'd say watching it at my grandma's house when I was about maybe 4 or 5. I remember I was watching, I think it was Jeff Hardy versus Big Show on an episode of SmackDown. And instantly I was like, whoa, like Jeff Hardy's awesome. So yeah, ever since then I wanted to do it. And I think I was about 6, 7 when me and my friends started trying to find wrestling schools online, but we just couldn't find anything around here and like in England. And then I found PBW Academy when I was about, I'd say 11, obviously up in Scotland. And I spoke to my dad about it and I was like, do you reckon I could like go up for 1 week and just see how I find it? And like he was like, yeah, I mean, there's probably like more around here, but we'll give it a go. And I saw on the website, it said like, just mentioned something about Drew McIntyre. And I was like, oh my God, he's in WWE. Like, this must be the place to go. So yeah, I went up there for a week and yeah, instantly I just loved it. So I just carried on training there. That's pretty much how I got there.
So how long is it to travel from where you are to PBW?
About 2 hours. Yeah, just on a Sunday.
That's commitment, if anything. So all because you saw this is where Drew McIntyre was, this is where I need to go.
Yeah, pretty much, honestly, yeah.
So I did see a photo not long ago. Must be just after one of your debuts and somewhere. That was yourself, Kenny Williams and your dad. So yeah. Was he the one that always, he'd be taking you up 2 hours there, 2 hours back every Sunday?
Yeah, my dad. Yeah, I don't know how he did it or why, but thank him for it. It's fantastic.
So did you have a bit of, I mean, obviously you do amazing flips and athletic moves, which I could only dream of. So did you have, before you started training, did you do a bit of like gymnastics? Were you always just no fear jumping about, or how'd that come along?
I never took any lessons or anything, but my mum's got this story she always tells everyone. I think I was like 2 or something. She said we went to this like theme park sort of thing. And she said apparently there was a crowd of people watching because I was just doing like front flips and stuff and back flips and no one knew how I'd done it. And she was like, how'd you learn that? I was like, I don't know. And I was just going for it. And like when I was younger, that's just kind of all my friends did because like all my friends liked wrestling too. So all we would do is just try and copy people we'd watch like Jeff Hardy, Evan Bourne and that, and just start trying all the flips on the trampoline. And that would progress to, you know, trying them on like your bed, the mattress, and then slowly, eventually you just get to doing them on the floor and then in the ring.
So I always ask people when they come for PBW because it's one of those places they don't have a ring, the ring you earn. So being a big fan, going to the school, thinking, right, so I'm going to get into a ring straight away, be able to do all these cool things, and you come in and it's mats. Was there a bit of a, okay, or were you ready just to take it on?
I was always excited to take it on. I was very confused, though, obviously, when I first got there. Because, like I said, I was a kid. I was, like, 11, so I didn't have a clue. I remember before my first ever training session, I was, like, talking to my friend, telling him that I was going up there. And then he was like asking me like, oh, so like, what are you going to do your first week? Like, do you reckon you'll like start using weapons? Like, they'll teach you how to like climb ladders and all that. And I was like, I mean, hopefully, yeah. And I got there and there was mats. And I was a bit confused, but yeah, adapt to it. And then, because I always said, if you can learn like to wrestle on mats, you can wrestle in any ring, you know. So I think it's definitely helpful.
I just imagine that walking in going, right, where's the bins? Where's the kendo sticks? Let's do this. So first experience then, like, so you're quite athletic. You're probably used to falling if you're practicing all these jumps and flips. So what was the hardest bit you found about training initially?
Initially, straight away, I wanted to get in there and like show I could do all these flips. I thought that was like, you know, like impressive and people would like that. And to be fair, when I first got into wrestling back then, I didn't even realize that it was like predetermined. You know, I literally didn't even realize. So I was kind of unsure. Like, I had a bit of an idea, but I wasn't like sure, you know, how it worked or anything. So yeah, that was one of the first things I kind of had to figure out. So then when I like, started realizing, you know, like how matches are structured and all that, that was quite a curb block. Like, oh, right. So you put them together, right? And even before like you get to that stage, obviously they have to teach you the basics and headlocks. And I would get quite frustrated because I'd be like, you know, like at first, like I'm traveling up here and I've like practiced all these stuff at home. I want to do matches. I want to get out there, blah, blah, blah. But then I was just like, oh, why are we just doing headlocks? Like, you know, I just didn't understand it. Obviously, you know, it's the little things that make you a better wrestler at the end of the day. But back then, I was like, what's going on?
I love that you went in just like, right, okay, let's do some wrestling. And you didn't know that wins and losses were, I mean, I'm sorry if anyone's listening to this and didn't know, but wins and losses are predetermined and it's a team effort kind of thing. And you were just like, no, no. Let's go. Let's just wrestle.
Yeah.
Well, I've done all the moves in the park. It's all good. So, I mean, during that long journeys then, were you just speaking about wrestling, or was that just like your dad was like, right, we've got 2 hours here. Just give me a bit of peace. Or was just all wrestling at the time?
Yeah, literally always just wrestling. It was all I talk about, honestly. It was always like just talking about. Well, actually, on the way up, I'd say I was probably quite tired. So sometimes I used to just sleep on the way up, but I'd always be so like buzzing after training on the way back. The whole way, I'd just be jumping about the car, just telling him about what I'd learned today and all that.
So when did you find out you were getting your first match, your debut?
Oh, like on a show or in training?
We'll go on a... Go both for training, because this will be obviously the first time you put all these things into motion. So what was that like for you?
So first match at training, again, I was kind of frustrated in a way because I couldn't pick things up quite quick, like the basics, I just couldn't get them, like timing, stuff like that. I don't know, something just wasn't clicking, and I also couldn't bump. Like I could bump by myself, but if someone was giving me a line or something, I couldn't bump. Some like psychologically, something would just not work and I couldn't do it. And it used to annoy me so much. And then obviously I'd see people who had started training after me and they were getting matches. And I was just like thinking like, oh, like will I ever get a match? Like when's it coming? And then all of a sudden it just came out of nowhere, to be honest. Like I was there. I used to take my friends up occasionally and I was there with my friend and we were sat there and we were getting selected like different people for matches, and they selected like a tag match, and usually when it's someone's first match it's a tag match, but again I wasn't expecting it to be me, and he's told me to stand up, and me and my friend just started freaking out, like, wait, no. And then yeah, went and had the tag match. I'm pretty sure I forgot everything that happened in it, just absolute train wreck, but I was still just so happy that I actually got it. Then I'd say, I don't even know how much longer after that it was, but I think my debut on a show was probably 2015 2016, I think, Academy Attack Show. And again, it's like, I was expecting like the tag match that you people usually get on their debuts, but I got a singles match and I like got to win in it. And I thought, oh my God, this is like quite a big thing for me. Like at this point, I was like, Jesus. And then I was like, damn, like, yeah, I must be doing pretty good. And then, yeah, I got a bit of a reality check when I got my feedback and realized how, yeah, where I needed to improve.
But yeah, you're speaking about the bumping bit. That's the bit. I mean, I've never done it. I've no intention to either because I don't like getting hurt. I don't see the fun in it. So I just like, not that you should get hurt, but like, nah, there's a chance, not doing it. But that's the bit that always kind of concerns me is I'm sure I could work out how to fall myself, but having to do it in time to make it look like someone's actually hitting me would be the bit where my brain would just go, oh no, let's give me a second here to think about it. I end up doing something like I don't know if you ever saw that Samoa Joe bump where he hit in the back and then he did a twist to land on his back. I thought I'd just do that all the time. I think I would just make it the easiest bump possible and it would look awful. Was it just you're just working too fast, or was it just you just like not letting things breathe? That often seems to be the pitfall of first kind of matches seem to be.
It was quite a lot of things. Again, I think it was just even back then, it was literally just, oh, I can do the moves. That's all I thought was important, is just like doing the cool moves, but it's the bits in between that mattered, you know what I mean? And even obviously it's the first time I was ever in front of a crowd, so I was used to just doing it at training. I had no idea, you know, the difference between obviously people at training cheering you on, they're there to cheer you on, they know what's going on. But when you're in front of a live crowd who've never seen you before, you know, you have to work to get their reaction for you. And I just, you know, back then I just didn't understand that whatsoever. So I was kind of just, you could tell I was just focusing on the match as if it was just me and him in an empty place. And that timing, just going through the motions, you could tell I was thinking like, what's coming next? Yeah, pretty much just a bit of a train wreck overall.
I mean, since then though, you've done pretty well. I mean, according to my notes, I've scribbled a few things down just so I don't lose my train of thought and things. I mean, you've had matches with the likes of Stevie Xavier for Pro Wrestling Scotland. So that seems to be where you kind of, along with PBW, you kind of burst into this whole Scottish scene, was through Pro Wrestling Scotland, Pro Wrestling Innovation. What was it like getting in the ring with the likes of Stevie Xavier? Because that's a big opponent to have, especially early on.
No, yeah, that was just really, really unbelievable. Because it was it's like obviously a lot of pressure. Having someone that good, that caliber, you know, be in the ring with you, you want to give them your all. And then on top of that as well, I got told that was like the first ever main event I would be in for a show. So I was just like, oh, I was a bag of nerves, honestly. I was terrified. We got in there. But he's so good. Like, he's just another level. And he was so calm. He could tell I was nervous. So he was just, you know, telling me everything, you know, like, it's all right. We'll just go through it, basically. He just calmed me down a lot, I think. And then we had 15 minutes for the match. But he said, it's fine, the main event, we can go over. So we ended up having like a 25, I think, minute match, which was, again, crazy because I'm used to having about 8 to 10 minute matches from training and stuff. So that was pretty crazy. And that whole night just didn't seem real at all, to be honest. And I remember getting back as well because I didn't really have any social media presence whatsoever. And I looked at my phone. I had like 20 something Twitter notifications, and like, I was just like, what's going on? Like, this is just crazy. And it was all just people tweeting about the match and that. It really was just incredible. He's so good.
Must be weird as well, because I mean, often I'm assuming that a lot of your social media is a bit confusing as well, because there is this YouTuber called Daz Black also. So you're probably thinking, Is that all for me, or is this just kind of just trickle down effect from there? I remember you speaking on Wrestling Daft in one of their earlier episodes about I think Rab probably brought up would mix up of the names of with their son Daz Black, who I only found out about this year because I got TikTok. That's the short time I've actually seen Daz Black. So Pro Wrestling Scotland, and of course, then you went into the Pro Wrestling Innovation Young Lions Cup. And I mean, from what I'd read, and I think what I wrote, possibly myself and someone else on the site, Adam, probably, we were putting you as the kind of the favourite. Not to put pressure on you beforehand if you read it, but what was it like going in front of all these different kind of crowds? And because you said that was something that you struggled with when you started. Is that something you kind of tried to just improve, try to bring people in? Or are you quite a shy, introverted person anyway?
Yeah. Like naturally, I just don't find that very comfortable. You know, like naturally, I wouldn't be the kind of guy that would just, I don't know, get on stage and start singing, for example. Definitely took a long time. Like even after I started improving in the ring, that was always the thing that like the last thing that just needed to click, you know, like feedback started to get into the point in the later years where it was like, you've got everything down in the ring, now you just need to, you know, bring that up. And yeah, definitely working different kinds of crowds 100% helps with that. So obviously there's all kinds of different crowds that will give you all kinds of different responses. And yeah, doing that that Young Lions tournament, that was really good as well, because that was my sort of the first time I'd ever had a kind of feud or story. Do you know what I mean? Because obviously going with different companies for different like one-off shows, there isn't really a story behind why you're facing someone. It's just put together. But whereas with this, you know, there was actually a story behind it. Danny Edwards and, you know, him and his crew come in and attacking me after other matches leading to the finals and stuff like that. I just thought that was really, really cool. It was awesome.
It also would have helped with that thing of being a bit not taking on getting crowds in involved into your matches, because these guys were just the worst. They were just Dean Ford, Danny Edwards and Matt Tyson. They were just doing all the bad stuff, so you just had to overcome it. So that's probably even better. But yeah, so you made it to the final. Unfortunately, didn't win. But and then your name just seemed to be everywhere. If there was a recommendation of who do you want to see on our shows, I'd always see your name popping about somewhere. I don't know if it's because you're quite unique to Scotland, and there's not that many guys that can do what you can do. So I don't know if that would be the case. And you also bulked up quite a lot. Were you quite conscious of trying to keep your style as well as getting bigger? Was there trying to balance that at all?
Yeah. It's always something like I wanted to improve. That was another thing as well with like the confidence and stuff like that. Like I'd watch back my matches and be like, oh God, you know, like I look terrible. And I'd be like my worst, my biggest like self-critic, you know, like saying I don't look good. I don't feel good and all that. So I knew I wanted to like look bigger. And as well, when I started like getting better in ring, I like had always had really high goals. I'm like, right, if I need to get to that next level soon, you know, I've got to look the part. I can't just be good in the ring. It has to be believable when I'm going against guys that are, you know, bigger than me, not kids my age. So yeah, I started trying to bulk up. And again, it took ages. It just, nothing was happening at first. But eventually, you know, you push through, start seeing differences. And then I think I never really saw any difference, like athleticism-wise. It kind of all just stuck. But I'd say after lockdown, I put on like a lot more as well. And obviously in lockdown, there wasn't really anywhere to practice or anything. And I remember coming back, stepping in the ring for the first time. And I tried to do, what was it? It wasn't even a shooting star. It was just a moonsault. And usually when I do the moonsault, I've got, you know, airtime. I can see where I'm about to land. And I went for it. Oh my God, I landed like the second my head got past that landed. I was like, Jesus Christ, I need to like work on this again. So again, I had to get back on the cardio, start practicing again, and yeah, slowly get it all back.
So less Kurt Angle moonsault, more Lita, where she's that kind of spring fall back. she's one of the skater ones. So from there, 2019 seemed to be the year that Daz Black was just huge, because you're in the final, you're the dark match of the final Pro Wrestling Elite show, and July 2019, of course, for reasons we all know why, it was the last one. But what was it like in front of so you've done your family shows, but PWE and maybe even BCW is kind of like your next, is your team, maybe, I would say. It's like that family team show. So big expectation because it's the last show. Do you put a lot of pressure on yourself when you go into the ring?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Is that one a fairly pressure-filled match?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. This is quite a weird one. So before that match, that same day, I was thinking so much about that match, you know, being nervous about it, that I did my first ever camp show as well. And I still don't know what went wrong. I was told possibly it's because, you know, I had my mind elsewhere and because I'm used to doing more complicated matches. I've never been on the camps where it's, you know, very family show orientated, you know, very simple structured matches. But for some reason, just something went wrong. And it was, yeah, like extremely wrong. The whole match just a blur. I had no idea what was going on. And yeah, after that, I was just like, oh my gosh, what just happened? I was in a real bad mood. And then we went to, I think it was in Air, wasn't it? That PWE show.
It will have been, yeah.
Yeah. So we went up to Air and yeah, already I was in this terrible mood. I was like, God, I really don't think I can do this. You know, not very good going off of what's happened today. But yeah, I think it was my dad and also my coach was just telling me, like, you know, like, you've got to just rub it off. These things happen eventually. It happens to everyone. It's good that it's happened now, you know, rather than tonight. So just make tonight count. So I was like, you know what? Yeah, I will. So I just gave myself up and went and did it. I wasn't really sure what to expect with the crowd, obviously, because of what was going on. I was like, I don't know how they're going to react, how they're going to be. Turned out for the pre-show, not many people showed up. And again, that was just a new experience. I'd never been on a pre-show before, so I wasn't really sure how that crowd would react. And yeah, it's all just experience, isn't it?
I suppose with the camps, like your coach, your dad says, like, you can shake it off because, let's be honest, camps are great for learning, but you don't need to put, like you're saying, you don't need to put on the most complicated of matches in the world. Yeah. People are there to do other things, and wrestling's a bonus that they're coming to see. And kids would just be happy if you kick people, because that's what they do in the crowd anyway during the shows as well. So going into PW, you're right. When you go into it, it could, not a lot of people turned up for the pre-show, but you don't know whether it's going to be a solemn affair, if everyone's going to be all serious for the night, or if you can be expressive, or it's a very complicated one. But for like when you went to BCW, again, it was another dark match, I think it was. But you're teaming with someone from NXT UK, or was, in Tucker. Yeah. So again, you've had these singles matches with the likes of Stevie. I've written down Kenny Williams, but cage match said no. I'm sure he did. I'm sure he had a match Kenny Williams. But you're going in teaming with someone who's actually been to NXT UK by that point. What was that like? It was just all listening? Was that just pretty much the order of the day?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, you cut out then.
Oh, did I? So for teaming with Tucker, was it just a case of just a learning experience? You just listened, he led you through, or were you able to get involved with the planning of the match?
Yeah, that was a tricky one, Tucker's. don't really remember too much about leading. I remember being really nervous leading up to it, obviously, and very confused as well, because I got told, you know, you're teaming with Tucker. And I thought, Tucker, isn't he from NXT UK? Like, I swear I watched him in that tournament. I was like, no, it can't be. It has to be a different person. So I was searching on, like, Instagram, like, Tucker. Like, who else is called Tucker? There's no way it's him. And then I couldn't find anyone else. So I was like, I don't know. And I was like, I don't want to sound stupid and, like, message someone and be like, is that that Tucker from WWE? And then go, no, of course it's not him. You know, and I'm like, oh, right. And then I saw BCW, you know, like, announce the match. And I was like, oh, my God, it is him. I was like, this is just crazy, like, really, really, like, out of nowhere. I just did not see this coming. And then, yeah, so I was very nervous leading up to it. And I hadn't really done many tag matches either. Like, if there'd been, like, a someone who'd been brought in to fight me, you know, someone from NXT UK, some, like, a big star like that, I've never, like, tagged with them as well. So I was, like, nervous about that as well. Like, oh, my God, what if I mess this up with him? And yeah, and got there. I think we all had bits planning it. I can't really remember too much of who did what, but yeah. Yeah, again, really cool experience.
That's right. You didn't want to be the guy that messed up and then Tucker would go back to NXT UK and go, oh, I had a terrible match with this guy the weekend. You don't want to sign him ever.
Yeah, low pressure.
And then from that point, you made it to ICW, which initially was, again, another dark match. It seems to be kind of the pattern we've got at the moment for new companies. But it was Fear Loathing 2019. So that was that SWG3, I think.
Yeah.
2019. So that was a big battle royal. Winner gets a roster place or title shot. I can't remember. That's a bit, I've had it written down. So this is ICW. People actually come to the pre-show for those shows quite often. So absolutely different crowds, an over 18s crowd. I'm assuming by this point you're barely over 18, if you were at the time.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of my questions seem to be, you did this, what was that like? But that is pretty much what this is. So over 18 crowd, what was that like?
God, that was like a turning point for me, definitely. So obviously when I first started traveling up to Scotland, the first, you know, company I started hearing about was ICW, the big one, you know, and I started hearing, oh, right, like, you know, they've got something going on with WWE. Like, this is crazy. Like, they're huge. And I found out, obviously, like, Drew McIntyre again. Everybody comes back to Drew McIntyre. Yeah, like, oh, he was the first ICW champion. Wow. So, yeah, that was always a major goal of mine, to get to ICW. And I was talking about this with my dad the other day, actually. And I remember thinking around about that time, when do I actually think I will get to ICW? And I was thinking, like, realistically, because loads of people kept telling me, like, oh, you know, this year you'll be in there. And I just kept thinking, no, like, there's no way I'm ready for that. And I was thinking, like, realistically, maybe like 5 years I might. But honestly, just did not see that coming, like, really at all. And I messaged my coach and I said, I said, is there any tickets left for ICW Fear and Loathing? Because I was wanting to, like, buy some. And then he went, I don't think you'll need any tickets because you're going to be on the pre-show. And I thought he was joking. And I was like, yeah, good one. Like, how do I get the tickets? And he was like, no, honest. And I was honestly did not believe him at all. And I remember I was at the gym and I just stopped working out. And I was just aggressively typing on my phone, like, telling me this is not a joke, like, come on. And then that was just very confusing because I got told through him that I was going to be in the pre-show. Never got contacted by anyone from ICW. So even leading up to it, I was like, is this a rib? Like, am I just going to show up and then not let me in or something? And I got in there. Yeah, everything was totally different to how it is at these shows, like family shows, just like, probably just because I didn't really know anyone, like, personally. It was very, like, very scary, and big, the arena backstage. And yeah, so eventually we got told what was happening, like what the plans is for the match. And then I was supposed to be out second, so it was me and Levi starting the match. And yeah, I was eliminated pretty quickly, but it was just so strange. Like, I just couldn't believe what was actually going on. And as well, I remember my mum was there, and she doesn't really understand what was going on. And she was like, "Wait, so you didn't win?" And I was like, "No." She's like, "Oh, well, why did you go then?" And all this. She was like, "Why did they make you win? I don't get it. I thought they liked you." I was like, oh my God. Also, I knew some people that had been in ICW and that they'd like had a match or two, and unless they'd really made someone notice them, that'd been it. And I was extremely worried that that was what was happening, because like I said, I was only in the match for like maybe like 3 or 4 minutes or something, and I just thought, like, I really don't know if I've done enough, you know, to make anyone notice me. And then was it this one or the next? I'm thinking about something else. I was thinking about my next ICW match.
Would have been Gonzo, but I love your mum's just like almost naivety about it, just going, yeah. Well, why did you go? There's no point if you're not going to win. I absolutely love that. So yeah, you're back for Gonzo. That was just the turn of the year. I think I've got February 2020. This is now the proper crowd. This is the actual full crowd, not the pre-show. So the full raucous, just chanting lot. What was that like? So you had your wee taste of ICW with the pre-show, but this was your first proper go.
That does remind me actually. So after obviously this, I was literally every day at home, I was just waiting to see if I'd get a message, you know, from Dallas or from someone from ICW, like to see if they'd noticed me or not. Nothing was coming. I gave it like a while and still nothing came. I was like, oh, God's sake, you know, like, that's it for me. They didn't even know I was on the show, I bet, like, because I'd never even talked to anyone from ICW. So I was like, I was probably just putting through a recommendation. No one even watched it. No one was impressed. Like, oh, it'll be ages till I get there. And then I started thinking, like, again, yeah, I'm still not ready for it then, obviously. And then I was in my dad's kitchen and I got a DM from Dallas asking if I was free February 2nd for Gonzo, I think it was. And I just freaked out. I was like, no way. Dallas just messaged me. Like, I literally didn't even think he knew what it was. And oh, that was just crazy. I honestly could not believe that one. I was so excited. So I said yes. Obviously, I went and did it. And yeah, I still wasn't sure, like, how Gonzo was going to be, obviously, because it was a fairly new show at the time. And obviously, it wasn't Fight Club. So I was like, is the crowd going to be different? Is it going to be the same, you know, Fight Club crowd or not? And then also the way it was being built up, Gonzo, it was like the cruiserweight division almost, it seemed like. And I was excited for that. Like, obviously, because I was like, right, this is where I can showcase it. And then I got, I went there, did the match. Felt really, really good. Because I was very nervous about the crowd, thinking like they're not gonna like me at all. That was another big thing as well. Obviously, working different kinds of crowds, like I said, at different shows, but they've all been like family shows, you know, a lot of kids in the crowd. And now it's this ICW crowd. Like, I was like, how the hell do you work this crowd? And obviously, there's cameras now and everything. I was like, God, I really don't know what I'm supposed to do here, because, you know, like, they're not gonna respond to the stuff, you know, families and kids would respond to, you know, like, come on guys, clapping and all that, you know, like, what's this kid doing? So yeah, that was a big learning experience too, just getting in my head thinking like, what am I gonna do about that? I really don't know. But yeah, it's kind of just one of the things where once you're in the moment, you start feeling it. And that's something that took a long time to actually get that. But that's pretty much just the secret to it, is when I started feeling it, feeling that they were actually invested in what I was doing. That's when I could start giving it back to them, if you get what I mean. It's very hard to explain, but yeah, it's kind of coming through naturally. That was kind of the secret to all of it. Kieran Kelly was incredible. He was so good. Did our match. I felt great. I went to the back and Dallas was there and he just congratulated me, said I did really well. And that just meant the world to me. And then he asked me, he said, yeah, there'll definitely be more. 100%. I couldn't have been happier then, honestly.
So you came back for their last show, 1st of March, against Craig Anthony, who we'll get to, of course. And then the world ended. So 2 weeks after that, of course, shows got cancelled, shut down, everything. And the lockdown pandemic, etc. It all began. How did you keep yourself occupied during the initial... There was two lockdowns. I can't remember the second one. I've been at home since the first one. But how did you keep yourself occupied? Because you're far away from training. Just what was it like?
In the first lockdown, I'd just finished school, or was technically still in school, but it was cancelled. So yeah, I guess it was finished. So I was waiting on predicted A-level results and waiting to see if I got into uni or not. So there was no schoolwork for me to do really for a while. So literally all I did was just work out. It's literally nothing. The only thing I did through all of the lockdowns was just spend pretty much half the day. I don't even know what I would do for half the day, just doing whatever. And then most of the day just spent in the gym or eating. That was it. Just eating nonstop. To be honest,
I did that too, but I didn't do the working out to actually counterbalance it.
Halfway there, at least.
So, did you watch a lot of wrestling during that time? What's your kind of watch habits when it comes to pro wrestling?
Yeah. I don't really watch TV much at all. I just find it very counterproductive. I don't like sort of wasting time doing anything really. Obviously, watching wrestling, you know, you learn from that, so I'm all right with that. Obviously the network, you can just watch anything, which is just awesome. So I watch a bunch of different stuff. Obviously I watch the weekly stuff that comes on, but I also just like watching, I don't know, if randomly I get I remember different parts of matches from years ago that I used to like. I think, damn, I want to watch that, and I just go and watch it. It happens all the time with totally random matches. The other day, I watched, what was it? Oh, the Shield versus Evolution, because I just remembered this one spot from that, and I was like, that was awesome. And then a couple weeks ago, obviously this isn't the first lockdown, but still, it's just examples like this. I just spent the whole day watching WrestleManias. Just old WrestleManias, and honestly, anything. I'm just a fan of it all, to be honest. Whatever comes to mind.
I've got the exact same kind of thing, because when you mentioned at the start, you remember the match with you seeing Jeff Hardy versus Big Show. Now, this will be a totally different match to the one you watched because of age, but I just remember one from 2000, and it was Jeff Hardy versus Big Show, and it ended with the Matt and Lee all jumping on top of Big Show for the finish. So once I finish this, I'm going to go find that SmackDown episode with that on, because I need to see it now, because all the things going around my head, that and Jeff Hardy win the Intercontinental title against Triple H, because that was amazing. That's my plans after this. But exactly the same. Raw Rumble season, I watch old Raw Rumbles. WrestleMania season, you watch old WrestleManias. So just see, that's the tradition of wrestling, yeah. Especially with the network. So October's round, this is when I've gathered, was when the tapings began. You would be contacted for the first closed door ICW tapings. So you've spent all your time working on this, working to a crowd thing, and now you're wrestling with no crowd, but with a camera instead. What were your thoughts getting back into the ring in front of nobody?
Oh, I was terrified. I was literally like, what even is this? Like, like, you know, you've never been taught how to do this. Your whole career you've been aiming towards, you know, getting in front of them big crowds. That's what you've always been taught, and now you're gonna do it in front of no people. Like, this is very, very strange. And I was like, in theory, does this make it easier or does this make it harder? And I was like, because this is going to be so weird if I'm just shouting at walls, you know, trying to get them feedback off them. And I was like, so strange. So I honestly just got rid of all expectations. And I was like, we'll just see what happens. I'll just, you know, give it as much as I can and we'll see. And we got to the tapings and who was it? Rafa? There was some ICW guys, obviously, in the first taping block with me. And I was thinking, like, oh, well, they must know what they're doing, you know, like, because they've done a few. Because I wasn't the very first one. I was contacted, like, a bit later. So I was like, oh, you know, I'll see what they do, sort of thing. I just remember all of them saying, like, oh, this is so weird. I have no idea what to do. Like, this is strange. I have no idea how this works. It's just really hard. And I was like, oh, brilliant. Like, this is going to be great. And, yeah, and I got out there. And I don't know. I think it was just because I've been waiting so long, obviously, to get back in ICW. It was like all I was thinking about. I was like, I'm not going to take this as like, you know, just half-ass it just because there's no crowd here. You know, like, I'm not going to, you know, like, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. So I'll just, you know, see how it goes. I was like, I'm just going to give it absolutely everything I can. And I did. And yeah, hopefully it showed. I mean, got to the Zero G title finals, so I mean, I must have been something, right?
Another final. So did you know when you went in initially in that block that it was going to be on the WWE network, or were you just expecting it to be on ICW on demand?
I got called way back in September, I think, saying that there's this plan for us to do tapings at some point starting soon, because you know, WWE want some content. And I was very confused. I was like, wait, you're asking like me to do that? Or are you just like, no, like, I'm not going to be on the WWE network now. Like, no way. That doesn't make sense. And again, there's a lot of time I just think the prank called and me like, come on. And then, so yeah, I didn't really hear anything about it. So I messaged and I said, like, so just to be clear, like, what is this about? Like, what's actually the plan? Is this going on the network? And I was told it's going on Fight Club, but it will eventually air on the network. And I was like, oh my God. So then I started thinking about it. And at that point they were putting on old Fight Club episodes weekly. And they were like really, really far back in time. And I was like, oh, they're just going to carry that on. So I'll probably be on the network in about 3 years then when they finally start coming on. And I was like, right, this is going to be weird then. And then we got to the first tapings and I remember we asked Dallas like what the plan was with it, and he was like, yeah, it'll be on, you know, like in a month or so, in the next few weeks. And I was like, oh right, this really is happening, like this is crazy. And then yeah, I remember the big build-up till the first ever tape, and everyone was just so excited, like when it was airing on the network, no one could wait. And I remember everyone just like watched it together on a call, and it was just crazy. I mean, I wasn't on it, but still, it's just like mind-boggling that it was on.
So when your episode came up, though, was it a case of it was there, but I would just like search your name to make sure your name could be found on the WWE Network scroll, or are you just like still in a bit of shock that you were on it in the first place?
Yeah, I did that as well, though. Yeah, I had to search it. I was like, oh my God, it comes up. But yeah, it's just, again, it was weird because it's one of them things where all of this is like surreal. Do you know what I mean? Like each step that comes, it doesn't seem like it actually happened. Like even getting into ICW the first time, that doesn't even seem real, like that ever happened. And it's like, obviously, like when it first happens, you think like, all right, so this is the start of this and now we'll get used to it. But no, I never really feel that. Like I never get used to it. I never even get used to like just anything. Because I feel like if you do, you get used to it and you get comfortable, you know, you start phoning it in and it's not special anymore, but it should be. Everything should be, you know, not taken for granted. So every time I'm on the network, you know, as soon as it's on, I go and watch it. And Yeah, just criticize it.
I mean, it's what, in 5 years you've went from being told that you're working too fast, not working to a crowd, and now you're on the WWE Network, which is on Peacock, which is in front of 42 million people. Potentially 42 million people will be seeing you wrestle. Which is, yeah, when you put it in that kind of context, it's just mad. And the fact that you're the thumbnail for a couple of episodes as well. So you're first person they see. I think that's how I ended up getting the picture for your graphic for this episode. Because I was like, oh my God, this guy is... That was my thought. It's like, he's wrestled for less than 5 years and he's now the actual... That's the person people see.
That's strange.
It's incredible. And of course, you did. You went to the final of the ICW GOG Championship tournament after you did the Lionheart League. So pretty much you're just being thrown into everything and just going for it.
Yeah.
Seems to be. And after every show, I go on Twitter and I do see all these things. Oh my God, Daz Black. Oh my God, Daz Black is doing all these things. We'll go back just for a little bit. Your nickname's the Orbit Breaker. Did you give that to yourself? Did someone name you it? How did that name come about?
I was in the Philippines in like 2019. It must have been 2019, I guess. Just before I was facing Stevie Xavier. And obviously I was like talking about it with my family. I was like, right, it's the main event, you know. And I was going through all these scenarios in my head, like, so what happens in a main event? Like, do they blah, 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 blah? And I was thinking, right, so there's all these things I need to work on, you know, to make sure it goes as well as possible. Like, right, I have to, you know, make sure my entrance is right. I've got to make sure all this stuff. And I've been toying about with nicknames for a while. I was thinking, yeah, like, I think I'm going to go for this. You know, it describes the character. You know, it's quite an edgy name, like Orbit Breaker. It's quite cool. So I messaged my coach and, like, asked what he thought, and I was thinking, this is awesome. Straight away he was like, oh no, that sounds terrible. I don't sure why he didn't like it, but he was like, I just don't like that. How about, so I suggesting other ones, and I just thought they were awful. And I was like, that doesn't so we like had a bit of a talk back and forth, and you say, yeah, just keep thinking of one will come along eventually. And then the next morning he messaged me and go, had a bit of a thought of that last night. I like it. I think you should use it. I was like, all right, okay. So fair enough. So I went for it. Yeah, I think it's all right. What do you think?
Well, like you're saying, it just represents your style perfectly, because yeah, Nobody seems to be able in Scotland, a bar maybe, Robbie Wishart, I suppose, is probably the only one I can think that could do kind of what you can do, the oldest high flying style. So yeah, it's definitely it suits what you do, the Orbit Breaker. And also kind of Daz black hole kind of thing. It all works all together.
About safe.
Right, so I'll move on to some of the fan questions, because some of them are just weird. But we'll get our way through them. We'll start with a normal one, which is Bronze Cello, of course, from, as pops up all time on Wrestling Daft. I said, when crowds are back, who do you want to square off with first?
I mean, I saw that question. Obviously, Craig Anthony replied to it. And yeah, that's an obvious one. It's got to be Craig, really. Like, I'm not sure, like, if I had to pick one, but definitely Craig's one of them, obviously. You know, we've got to. We won a piece now. I won the first, he won the second. We've got to square off one more time. Other people. I mean, obviously, I set huge goals for myself. So Noam Dar, obviously. That'd be incredible. Just anyone really that they want to give me, as long as they can elevate me, give me more experience. Yeah, throw them my way.
Mayhem Brooks asked, what do you ask for when you get a trim?
Oh God, don't even talk about that right now. So this is quite bad. I went to the hairdressers, obviously the first time after lockdown, and I told them I'm trying to like grow my hair out now. I think that'll look quite cool. I think it's about time, because I've been contemplating for years. I'm like, I'm just going to go for it. So he was like, yeah, cool. So what we're going to do today is just like trim up the fringe, which I thought was a bit strange because they were growing out. He's like, because I want it to all grow at the same length. So we're going to keep the sides really long as well, but we can shave the bottom of them. So you probably won't see it because of the cap. But when this gets like sweaty, it just comes straight out and it's all the same length. I just have like a little bowl cut afro sort of thing. So yeah, it's going to be interesting for the next few months.
So you're not hoping for lockdown to continue any longer, but you know, it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. So yeah. When you come out of it, well, because there's always that awkward period. I know that I would know because, you know, but there's always that awkward period in the middle where it just looks like a bob before it becomes longer.
I'm not looking forward to that. AJ Styles and all them soccer mum head things. Oh, I hope that doesn't happen to me, but I feel like it's coming, you know.
For anyone wondering, I did a zero cut. That was this morning myself for free. So there you go. Ian Skinner's just asked, can you do a flip though? I'm assuming, I can see from the area that you're sitting in, that's a no. it would be amazing, but no. So we'll leave that one aside. Jason Hyde asked, does your mum think he's handsome?
Not my mum. Ask Ricky, see what he says.
Tom Humphreys on Instagram asks, just what's your favourite flip? Is there any particular one you enjoy doing?
That's right. My favourite flip. I mean, I guess it's got to be some kind of backflip since that's all I really do. Yeah. Some kind of shooting star. Let's go for that. I think that's quite cool. Because one thing that I saw as well, there's a lot of guys who have my style, obviously. A lot of guys that can do loads of crazy, crazy things I can't do. Like, some of the stuff Pat can do and Will Ospreay is just like, what? Like, how? Like, I saw a video of Pat doing a Phoenix 630 the other day. I was like, that's not even possible. Like, how? But I saw, those people doing shooting stars over the years and that. I always thought, you know what, I think I've got the best shooting star in wrestling. You know, people like Tyler Bate and that, they kind of do that cheat one where they go over the shoulder, or they kind of set up with a twist to kind of help cheat. A lot of people don't realize that just helps you get over. So
it's like
I've got one thing I can do better than.
It's like a difference between, say, we'll go back to moonsaults, like a Kurt Angle moonsault where he just goes straight back, or a Bam Bam Bigelow, where it is kind of like that twisting over shoulder one, which, exactly. I mean, if I could do either, I'd be happy. But yeah, there's a little bit of difference. But yeah, when it comes to, like, Pac, you mentioned Pac. I got to see him wrestle once in Aberdeen, and I still don't know how the Black Arrow's done. I don't know how he does it, because he twists, and then he seems to, halfway down, get his landing position ready. Like, how? Who did you get
My favorite move ever in wrestling is that. Like, it's unbelievable. God damn, I love that so much. I'd never try it because it's just stupid. Like, how? I could do it like, I know how he does it on the trampoline, but I just know I cannot do that. Like, I still don't get how it's even possible that he can do that. It's incredible.
Is it one of those situations where it turned out like AJ Styles' spiral tap, which, I don't know how he's supposed to land it because it's never landed the same way.
Yeah, pretty much.
So we'll look to the future then. I've got my stupid questions in a bit, but we'll get into the future. You're booked for or announced for Prime Wrestling, their Smoke and Mirrors show. That's a little bit, is that a little bit closer to home in the space of things?
Not like where I'm living now, but I'm living in Newcastle next year, so that'll be like really close, so that'll be handy, which is quite weird because like when I first got in contact with him, I wasn't like planning on going to, you know, uni in Newcastle or anything, so I thought, you know, it'd be a long travel and that, but yeah, now the way things have come on with COVID and that, I'm literally going to be like on the doorstep, so that'll be quite good.
And there's a lot of companies in and about Newcastle. There's North, I think. There's MEW. I'm just guessing. I put myself into a corner there. But is there kind of companies in Newcastle that you want to check out? Is there anywhere that you want to get to? I know you set lofty goals, so I'm assuming NXT UK is the next step. But in the meantime, where else are you trying to get to?
I don't really know in Newcastle. I really wish WCPW was still a thing, because that would have just been awesome. Because obviously, like, when Ospreay went there, that kind of just blew him up. I remember, like, when he started appearing on that, he just kind of went everywhere after that. So I really, like I said, that was a goal when I saw that. I wanted to get there. But obviously, that's, like, that is finished now, isn't it?
It changed to Defiant, and then it closed.
Ah, yeah. So that's kind of annoying, but I'd love to get to, like, you know, other places in England, like Progress and that. I think that'd be so much fun. I'd love to go there. Yeah, there's a lot of places, to be honest.
It's always the way. If someone asks you the question, you have all the answers in your head when you start. As soon as I hit record and ask you, it's like,
yeah,
they're all gone. I can't even name a wrestler now. We mentioned, like, who you want to face next when shows returns to Craig Anthony and Noam Dar. Who would be your dream opponent then? Who face anyone? Make it, it's WCPW. They've got money everywhere. They could book anyone. Who are you facing?
Oh, there's so many. How can you pick one? Jesus.
I'm guessing Pac, AJ Styles, Jeff Hardy, yeah. Ricochet, 100%. Will Ospreay. Yeah.
Because, yeah, like, all for different reasons. Like, obviously, if you, like, wanted to, like, face your hero, childhood hero, that's obviously a goal for everyone. So it'd be, like, Jeff Hardy. If you wanted, like, someone that could, you just want to absolutely tear it up with, it'd have to be Pac and Ospreay. They're just so friggin' good. Yeah, it's just so many, honestly.
Right, let's move on to my ridiculous questions that we ask in these episodes. I aim up with this that bit beforehand because I know that I'm going to ask someone like super professional one day that'll just look down on me when I ask them. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, I literally found out the name of it the other day. That's so weird. Began with an M.
What's it from, and what's it, what is it? What does it look like?
We'll find out. The biggest, biggest sea creature ever.
Oh,
it's like gigantic. Was it like a
mole something? Oh, it's going to annoy me. I'm going to find out. Right, it's a molassus. It's like a massive whale.
No, I had a real long name. What was it? Something.
Is it a swimming one or is it just a land one?
I think it was a swimming one.
Okay.
It was on like a thing of like the biggest creature that ever lived. I mean, I think it was real. Might have made it up.
Oh, we'll find out. Oh my god, there's so many. It could be anything. Doesn't come with quick. Well, it does come with pictures, right? Sorry to everyone listening to this. This will just take a moment while I look for a swimming dinosaur. They all walk. This isn't helping me at all. But no, there's... Right, okay, we're lost. But, okay. Let's... Master dinosaur that swims starting with M. That's what we're going with as the answer.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll find it later. And it's, anyway. Yeah, another question we ask is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
Is that just gut feeling, or is there any like thought behind it?
I saw a cow yesterday, and I was looking at it for a while. This just sounds so weird. I was like, "That is huge! Like that thing really is big, bigger than you think. Like that could demolish some sheep." So, yeah.
It's one of those questions either you put in far too much thought or no thought at all. Honestly, I thought I'd just start with a joke. I saw a cow yesterday and she wouldn't move in the queue. But anyway, right. Okay, I think I've covered everything that I want to do. So, of course, you did a bunch of tapings for ICW. Of course, at this point, some of them have went out, some haven't. Is there anything that we could possibly look forward to seeing that you know that you've done? I don't need spoilers. Don't want spoilers, but... Is there any matches that you're particularly proud of to have people see coming up?
Yeah, there's a match. I'm not sure when it's coming out. I'm not going to say who it's against, but there's two, actually. There's one that's coming up, which has a lot of meaning for me, which is kind of, it was like out of nowhere, like, oh, wow, this is like quite a personal story behind this. So I think that's cool. And then there's another one coming out, which was just crazy. Like, again, I like matches that like elevate me and teach me a lot in a match. And there's one that taught me a lot in a match. And there's things in it that I know why they were done, that like mean a lot to me. Like there's something that happens. I'm trying not to give anything away, but yeah, one should be pretty good. I think some people will like it. So yeah.
Just before I finish up, then about sticking on these tapings, because they're so fascinating. Because in the moment, this is our only outlet of wrestling in Scotland. Anyway, you do quite a lot of the between matches promos, which. Yeah. Some can be a bit awkward to not yourself, but just in general can be a bit awkward to watch, because a lot of the older, the veterans, they play to a crowd, so they pause, which is super weird to watch. How are you finding? Are you finding that's helping you as well? You're cutting these promos in front of a camera, get your confidence up, or are they still a little bit weird to do?
Yeah, like I said, that was one thing that I always struggled with, again, with like the crowd thing. Like, it's just one of them awkward things that I always just found was very weird. I used to get in my head about them a lot when I was younger. And yeah, like when I had like first went to ICW Fight Club, I remember they said I was filming a promo, and I was like, I knew this was coming, but well, I didn't know, but I was like, I had a feeling this was coming, but God damn, this is going to be nerve-wracking. And you could see how nervous I was. I was like, oh my God. And yeah, obviously, when the tapings came, I was like, well, surely there's going to be promos in it, because, like, obviously, it's ICW. And yeah, when I started them, I was, again, nervous. Not as nervous as the first time, but a new kind of nervous too, because it's even, I'd say it's even, like, almost scarier, because the first time there was a lot of people around and, you know, they're all doing their own thing, but this time it's literally you standing in front of a camera with complete silence and someone, you know, people recording it. It's like, oh my God, all the attention's on me. Like, you know, so it's pretty nerve wracking, but yeah, and it's all just learning, something you get used to. And yeah, something you can quite like after a while.
I mean, like I said, it's only 42 million potential people watching it. It'll be fine.
Yeah, exactly.
So thank you for joining me today. Where can people find you on social media?
It's Daz Black PW on Instagram, PW_Daz on Twitter, and every week on the WWE Network. Near enough every week.
nice plug at the end. Perfect. Well, thank you very much again. Cheers.
Thanks a lot for having me. Thank you.